Hi folks, it's Sven Jungbeck again, and today it's how to improvise on All of Me. And I prepared some concepts for you that will help you to develop a more authentic sound while soloing, and that will also help you to understand the tune better. If you don't know the chords and the tune, check out my video Proper Chords to All of Me in the link above. It will help you to play the rhythm guitar and to figure out how the tune works. Well, the whole tune, to say that first, is in C, and this makes it pretty easy, because you will notice that even with the A minor pentatonic or the C major pentatonic, which is the same scale with like C, D, E, G, A, and again C, you will get along quite well on the tune. It's even possible. There are some secondary dominants like E dominant 7, A dominant 7, D dominant 7, and also the F minor chord that are not directly in the scale, but that are very, very much related to the scale. So, and if you play all that with the pentatonic scale, you will see that somehow that works quite well with your ears, but it's not the real deal concerning authentic sound and stuff like that. This is also the same with the C major scale. You can play the C major scale almost throughout the whole song. You won't really get into trouble, but there are some places, you know, where you might have the feeling there should be something else happening. And the first exercising leading to that is finding the special notes. And in that case, these are the thirds of the secondary dominant chords. When you start, for example, with the C major scale on the first chord on C, it's of course perfectly working, but now we go to E dominant 7, and all you gotta do is replacing all G notes with a G sharp note. Instead of playing C, D, E, F, G, you're now playing C, D, E, F, G sharp. That scale can be called harmonic minor, but I'm not a fan of that. This is the wrong perspective. You should really feel like I have to play G sharp as a note, because it's the third of E dominant 7. You have to learn thinking in notes at all, because thinking in notes or in sounds is what makes you a jazz player and not just playing scales. I did that for a long time. When I was a teenager, I learned all the scales wrong. Just, you know, try to speed up and stuff, and I had no idea of what I'm doing. And of course, when you try to play jazz, it's like a big stop sign, and you know, nothing's gonna really work. So try to play a phrase and end up on that G sharp. Let's say we got the C here, and then we go to E dominant 7, and then you try to play C like, end up on the G sharp. Make it very clear. Something like that. The same thing with the A dominant 7. The magic note here is C sharp. It's the third of this secondary dominant chord that leads to D, and the C sharp of chord leads to D. On the G string 6th fret, going to the 7th fret, to D. It's here, and of course here. And try to figure out these notes. C sharp, then we go to D minor. Now we're back in the scale. All notes of C major are fitting. Again, back to E dominant 7. We're heading again for the G sharp notes. Then we go to A minor, completely in the scale. And then we go to D dominant 7, and here we're trying to find the F sharps. And this, if you do this playing C major scale and only trying to hit the thirds, the sound will already be very good. I will demonstrate that in a kind of solo. Get an intro here, and then I will start. There we go. Thank you. that now you really hear the chords moving. And when you try that, you can try to make the space, the place where you try to achieve that, to make that place very small by, you know, limiting yourself to only a few strings. For example, D, G or B, it doesn't matter, but try to find out these melody movements. For example, when you play C, the fifth of C, it's G, and then you play. Now we go to the G sharp. Now on A we play the root. On D minor, for example, we can still play A because it's the fifth. Then we go back to E. E minor. D dominant 7 again. The fifth is working. D minor. And then G. And then you only play it on that one string. But still, you got a little motive there and it's working. It's not, of course, a perfect solo, but it's working. If you do it, for example, a string higher, I can try to make that sound right for you. If we now move to the, instead of the D string, to the B string, and I will try to start on that G. Now on C, I play G. G sharp. A. Sharp. Back to A. This is something. Let's play further for the F minor. Now F major with the. This, you know, and it's really cool that the F minor chord, the third of the F minor chord is A flat, and it's the same note than G sharp. So the third of F minor is the same third than the one of the E dominant 7 chord. And knowing where these G sharp slash A flat is on the fretboard will help you. So practice C major and try to figure out every G sharp slash A flat, like here, like everywhere, you know, just try to figure out all these notes, and that will help you a lot. So, one more little thing, you can, of course, try to do this exercise with different colors, you know, you can start on any string at every place and try to figure out the correct notes. For example, on the B string, when you start on the B string, E is the third of C, it's the root of E. It's the fifth of A, it's the nine of D minor. So you can stay on a note and try to play some motifs on it, and then, you know, add the next special note around. For example, that G sharp, you start on the C. Having here the G sharp third, you know. Then we go to A and you. Stuff like that, and that will help you to develop a very good knowledge and to be and the ability to play good motifs all over the fretboard. Okay, that was the first thing. The next thing, which is very important, and this one is probably the most important one, is learn licks and transcriptions, because licks are somehow the language of the music and they have a bad taste, for they seem to be not creative or stuff. But this is really nonsense. All the players play licks, everyone learned licks, and licks will make your solo sound, you know, strong and confident. For example, when I start playing motifs and then compared to licks, the mix is of course good, but licks, for example, are really, you know, drive you through the sound of Gypsy jazz.
Thank you.
was trying to say. Now, it was not very creative what I played, but still, it you know, it just makes the sound of the music somehow, and that will help you to develop a lot of things. And I recommend not learning licks from guys like me or Christian van Hemert, who is a great teacher, but learn licks from the greats. You know, don't learn licks from us teachers. There is the French guy, he's very good from his guitar improvisation, or what it's called. Great guys, but when you learn licks of the really good guys, of the big names, you know. In Gypsy Swing, of course, Django licks, Stoffel Rosenberg licks, Joshua Stefan licks, Pirelli Lagrène licks, Adrien Monnier, Rocky Grisset, whatever their names are, and of course licks also from other players of other styles. Wes Montgomery, not only guitar player licks, maybe you learn some licks from Stefan Grappelli or from Miles Davis, but this is really the good stuff, you know, and you should learn a lot of those and a lot of the typical guitar licks, of course, that make your playing sound strong. And in that video, I won't show you too many licks, just the recommendation, learn the licks from the greats. And licks are easy to get, actually. A lot of people teach them, and there are a lot of books full with licks. So the next exercise that you should do, and this one is very uncomfortable, but nevertheless, you got to do it all the way. It's the arpeggiator. That means you're playing all the arpeggios of the tune, and you can start with the arpeggios that you got in your books. For example, on C, you can play a C major 7 arpeggio. A C major 6 arpeggio would be, of course, the more typical sound. But if you look at that, you know, try it first, figure out all the notes, like for example, G, C, E, G, C, E, G. Then you add the major 7. Six, which makes it actually an A minor 7 arpeggio. A minor 7 and C major 6 are the same chords. And now you try to set the metronome at a very slow pace and arpeggiating the whole tune. If I will do it now, I'd probably make mistakes, because once you get it and you're, let's say, confident and secure with licks and phrasing and motifs, then you don't practice these scales any longer. But it would sound something like that, and it will help you to figure out how the tune really works. Position, of course, stuff like that. And this is a very good exercise, and it will help you to get more confident in Gypsy Jazz. The last thing has to do with harmony, and it's a bit more complex. So each style, and Gypsy Jazz, of course, too, has a certain harmonic structure which is typical. And it's typical in a tune like that when you play Gypsy Jazz and you go to the A dominant 7 chord. Then you pretend that D minor would be the next tonic, and on the A dominant 7 chord, you're not only adding the C sharp to the C major scale, you're replacing at that point the C major scale, pretending you would be in D minor. And then you not only add on the A dominant 7 the C sharp, but also the B flat, so that you play somehow D harmonic minor leading to D. And this is a typical sound, like. Typical phrase. And another typical thing is that on the E dominant 7 chord, instead of just playing the arpeggio, you play the dim chord of the third, of G sharp. Stuff like would be a typical lick. Stuff like that. And this is very the dim chord on the dominant chord, on the secondary dominant chord. On the third is a very typical sound to Gypsy Jazz. And try to figure out the third movement from F major to F minor as much as you can. From stuff like that. Hope you liked it.